Where are we, Virginia?
I'm standing next to the table where Ernest Hemingway was regaled by his grandfather after grandfather, or Abba as he was called, after his breakfast in the morning. Abba owned this nice 1890s home and invited his daughter and her new husband to join him in this house in 1896 when there was a wedding about to take place.
And Ernest lived here until roughly when?
He was 6 years old. His grandfather died. The house was required to be sold at grandfather's behest. And the family built a new house in Oak Park, during the construction of which they lived in a little house from the 1870s right next door to the library, which had the first children's library in the state of Illinois.
Ah.
So Ernest went from this house and his storytelling grandfather to living right next door to the library. And upon completion of their new home, he grew into that house as a young teenager, a young high school boy, and came back there after World War I injuries and went on to become Ernest Hemingway that we know. I'm Virginia Casson, and I am a board member and previous chairman of the Ernest Hemingway Foundation of Oak Park. I am a retired city clerk for the Village of Oak Park. I'm the mother of eight, and I won't go into the rest of the claim, but that's about the size of my life.
And?
Red Griffin, I'm a founding director and past chair of the Ernest Hemingway Foundation of Oak Park. Had no choice but to be interested in Hemingway because my mother and Ernest's sister, Sonny, shared a hospital room in Oak Park, and her son was born the day before I was, but she was like an aunt to me and told me a great deal about his life, especially the spiritual side of it, that has had a lifelong influence and many things that I've tried to do in either Reader's Theater or exhibit design or lectures are inspired by her and Molly Daniels, who is a wonderful teacher of writing at the University of Chicago, who based her whole method on Hemingway and Sherwood Anderson's spirituality. Ernest's writing is Death in the Afternoon is credited to his ability to describe something so well that caused a certain inner response in him, that by describing it that way for the reader will have the same response he did. Well, it's the sciences from his father through journalism in the high school through the Kansas City Star that helped Ernest really develop his ability to observe and describe things well. And it was his mother who taught him to be sensitive to his feelings, to the imagery within from the arts, that provided that inner sensitivity. And so when he brought together what his father in journalism taught him and his mother in the arts and poetry taught him, you have great passages like Farewell to Arms.
Can we just chat a bit about his beginnings as a writer, right here in this neighborhood?
He was, he felt that he was compelled to write. He wrote in a little pocket notebook that he had that in his lifetime he would travel and write. And his hopes and dreams came true. When he entered Oak Park High School, which was a very advanced school at that time, he had inspired teachers who saw in him the skills to be nurtured. He was very fortunate to have an education which ended with his high school education, in spite of the fact that his family anticipated he would continue and have a college education, which was set back a bit by the fact that World War I was breaking out. He graduated in 1917. But during that time, he was inspired to write for their newspaper.
The high school newspaper.
The high school newspaper, and
under a different
also
byline.
For the what they called the Trapeze, which was their periodic newspaper. And the man who was in charge of that inspired him to get involved and become the editor of those periodicals. He wrote, he reported on the sports events. He wrote some poetry. He wrote about events at the school, kind of a current events type thing. And he wrote about things going on in the world.
He learned to put poetry into prose, which he said was the hardest of all things to do. So the key to understand Hemingway is how this first interest of him in writing poetry, which he was not that successful at ultimately, even though he had six of his poems at least published in the poetry magazine. It was poetry he wanted, but then he realized, and part of the tragedy, of course, of his wife's having these works that she was taking to the publisher, which in some of the biographies of Hadley talked about, that was maybe a blessing in disguise because it forced him to begin to write more prose and to put poetry into prose, yes. But stories and poems. I think those are the things that Hemingway loved. We know that when he was 3 years old, he memorized Charge of Light Brigade and used to put on the uniform of a soldier with a little stick for a gun and recite that, which is pretty good for a three-year-old. And he loved this to shout his stories to the trees when he went out to the woods. His friend Lou Clarahan said that he loved Robin Hood, and he'd play the parts of Robin Hood when they were running off to fish in the river. And once outside of Oak Park, he just burst out and yelled and shouted and come up and hit Lou in the chest. He'd get so excited with these stories. So he loved to tell stories, and even he did now and then tell tall tales, and he got in trouble. Jenny probably can tell you at the birthplace about how his grandfather said, this kid will either do well or end up in jail, but you know, he had this love to tell the fictional stuff. So I think that that love of stories, spoken orally as well as written, was a major force. Now, Ginny mentioned a very moving thing, and that is in the Tabula of 1917, Blackjack Pershing was in Paris organizing the expeditionary forces for Europe in World War I. The night before, Ernest graduated from high school, and war was in the air, the introduction, which Ernest had written in the book, so he well may have been a part, he was an editor as well. Their class is very moving because it's looking ahead to the future, what to expect. And they talk very idealistically about they'll take the burden on or whatever. They didn't see the future as very bright. They saw the future as war. And Ernest, early on, saw it and, of course, wanted to get into war. And because of bad eyesight, wasn't able to. But ended up, of course, driving for the ambulance corps. That war gave him tremendous material for a story. In fact, up in Petoskey, Michigan, where Ginny and some others from our foundation were at a wonderful international conference, there's a in the museum there, there's a letter from Ernest writing to a friend of his saying that this is the Farewell to Arms was the story I told you about in 1919 when he visited at Petoskey. And so that story was already on his mind, but he didn't get around to publish it until 1929. Had a lot of time to gestate, a lot of time for all of that thoughtful preparation to make. So I think, you know, you could learn a lot about writing from studying how Hemingway came to write Farewell to Arms. And he came back to the high school here after he'd been in the war with his bloody uniform and showed the students and put on a shot of one of the starburst outside the school, and went to the YMCA here and showed him his wounds on his legs from the war, shrapnel wounds. So he was, they call him Hemingway the hero, and they all chanted for him when he came back. So you see, he found also it's telling stories could make you popular. And so his time coming back to high school, he was a hero. And of course, he was the first, I believe the first veteran, first American to be greeted at the ship in New York, first one wounded, I think, in Europe. And he was, I think, on the front page of the New York Times. It was in the paper.
And he received a beautiful plaque from the Italian Americans in Chicago.
And was decorated in Italy, wasn't he?
It was.
Yeah.
Received a major decoration.
Yes, that was, and we have pictures of him marvelously holding it. You have to remember, he wasn't in the war very long, because he was wounded badly enough to have to be
hospitalized. And under 20 years old.
Yeah.
Yes.
He was an actor
you
also.
You asked about the storytelling. His grandfather, in whose house this young lad was born, and from whom he learned many things, was wont to tell after breakfast, his breakfast in the morning, to the little children in the house, Ernest and three siblings, a story after grandfather, Abba, he called him, had eaten his breakfast, he went into a story every day for the children. And they, of course, welcomed him down the stairs in the morning, held his hand, walked him to the table, and stood around the table waiting for grandfather to tell this continuing story every day. One of the aunts who lived right across the street was a professional storyteller and in costume traveled and told stories. So Ernest's grandfather was looking ahead, and as Red said, you know, to Ernest's mother, this little lad with all this imagination is going to be heard from someday. Either he's going to be famous or he's going to be in jail. When Ernest was 12, he wrote his first story. It was called A Sea Voyage. And it was a story told to him by a great uncle who lived in the house with the family and who traveled selling grass beds all over the Middle West, but who had been a part of the earlier part of the family story. And he had wonderful stories to tell. One of Dad's, his father Clarence, Dr. Clarence's brothers, was a missionary in China. Came home periodically with wonderful stories about his time in China. So Ernest not only was learning about the Middle West from Uncle Tiley, but the great uncle in China was coming home on sabbatical with his stories, and across the street was Aunt Grace, who was telling stories professionally. How could he have missed?
Well, I'd like to throw out that from the earliest age, he was exposed to people like, you know, the great Tennyson and Shakespeare and so on. But the family library, as you'll see, was stocked with great stuff. And Oak Park had the first children's library in Illinois. So while he was temporarily living next to the library, he spent a lot of time in the library. So he was really absorbing the best of the Western heritage from the earliest years. Now in high school, there are actually people who have done doctoral theses on this. The principal that he first came under was a principal who was legendary for trying to bring about a change in the curriculum, high school curriculum. That is a shift away from the Bible and pure classics to more contemporary literature, like Jack London, Ring Lardner. I'm not sure if they taught it, but Hemingway was beginning to get interested in those writers. And there was a lot more openness to contemporary, and also stress on writing, as I recall. I think as Hemingway progressed, his allegories and metaphors became far more profound. I like to think he went from, say, you know, straight reporting to what I call literary art, and finally to great literature. And The Old Man of the Sea is some of the greatest literature, which is profoundly spiritual work, in which the old man says that if he's successful in catching a fish, he will make a pilgrimage to the shrine, the Virgin de Cobra, in Cuba. Well, in fact, Hemingway himself went there and left his Nobel Prize medal at that shrine. Hemingway had a great interest in the more than the physical side of life, and it comes through many stories, like the stories where his soul leaves his body and sees it on a bed. He, in the case of Farewell to Arms, he talks about being hit by as he actually was hit by fire. Frederick Adams is hit by fire, and he talks about the tremendous visual impact of this, and his soul going out and out. So many, many times, even apart from traditional religious references, there is what we would call the belief that there's something in the human being besides the physical. And you cannot understand his work without grasping that. And so at the very minimal, Hemingway's work is spiritual, and it acknowledges something in life beyond what we normally see. Beyond that are the issues of morality, which he deals with. As one man has said, that the first part of Snow's a Kilimanjaro is Ernest, is his prototype, or his protagonist confessing to his things in his life where he made mistakes. And after that confession, Hemingway considered himself a Catholic. He has this wonderful experience of dream of crashing into that house of God, into the mountain. You can find this all through his work. Let's say in The Sun Also Rises, it's the man who is spiritual and the woman who is not. In Farewell to Arms, it's just the opposite. But one of the characters is usually a spiritual adept, and the other one is a spiritual learner or apprentice or disciple. But you have to look for it. If you look in Farewell to Arms, there's dialogue between the priest who comes from Abruzzi, this perfect place where the hunting is great, the fishing is great, where the snow is beautiful in the winter, and the priest comes down to the lower valley, which is muddy and dirty, and there's prostitution and gambling and foul language and so on. And Baker says, this is the higher land, the higher ground where the priest comes from, and the lower ground where these folks that are dirty in life, either physically or morally. And Hemingway is dialoguing with this priest at one point about where is God, or does he believe in God, and so on. He gets into very deep questions. And one of the points is that he says, sometimes I think of God in the night. Sometimes the priest says, no. He says, that's not God, that's lust, or something like that. And he says, but lust, love is not lust. It's when you do things for, you care about people. And so in the same story, Frederick Henry risks his life to save a Italian soldier, just as Hemingway did in real life. So that's giving your life for another person is the ultimate. So if you're looking for it, you can find that is running all through Hemingway, and I think that's probably the most exciting part. We had a scholar right here in this room back in 1993, we had an international scholars conference right here. Scholars from all over the world, as they just assembled in Michigan, and later we had one in 1999. This man is from California, and a good scholar, well known. He said when Hemingway was writing The Old Man and the Sea, he was reading two works that were very influential. One was The Dark Night of the Soul by St. John of the Cross, and the other was Imitation of Christ by Thomas Kempis. Now, if you read that, in light of that, you begin to really see the profound spirituality. And we had a paper done in Chesterton, Hemingway, recently. And Chesterton, of course, was a convert to Catholicism. Hemingway mentions him in The Three-Day Blow. But you can find that Chesterton and Hemingway have some marvelous things in common. Both journalists, both are spiritually seeking. And so if you're really looking for it, you can go on and on and find all kinds of sources for Hemingway's spirituality. And I would say mysticism. I'd say mysticism is part of what makes him great.
We've gone from sort of growing up in this neighborhood, writing for the high school newspaper, going off to war, actually learning the craft of how to construct a sentence from a newspaper in Kansas, to suddenly falling into what has to be one of the most exciting times in literary history, Paris in the 20s. And the influence
of people.
And
not only Paris in the 20s, but he was newly married.
Right.
He was madly in love with Hadley Richardson, his first wife. They found a beautiful bookstore called Shakespeare's Bookstore.
Which is noted for what?
And they just were treated like princes. Any book they wanted to take out was theirs to take it out. And here was this remarkable woman serving the whole literary group of emigres. Of course, the lost generation, Gertrude Stein, instantly I just read that she got that from somebody else too, so that was not something she thought of. But this was a group of people who just fed off each other, artists, writers, musicians.
All a bunch of deadbeats no one's ever heard of.
But by the way,
What were some of the names?
Ezra
Pound, Gertrude Stein, Scott Fitzgerald,
James Joyce, Fitzgerald.
And of course, Ernest was not very grateful to the one that took
Sherwood Anderson.
It was just, you know, a treasure trove. And you could sit all day in a cafe and write on the one cup of coffee you'd bought in the morning until you wore your pencil down. Ernest, of course, found a little garret place where he could write, where he was not in the domestic quality of his household, and particularly after he had a little child born. He had a little question about whether there was room in his life for a little child, but of course grew to enjoy Jack Nicanor, named after one of the bullring stars. He found, of course, that life was much more complicated when a second beautiful woman from Vogue magazine came into his life. And his travels into Switzerland to ski, and travels because he was reporting for the Toronto Star and had a number of times away from home at some length to prepare dispatches for that. This was heavenly for a man who's trying to get his ground.
Oh.
And Paris, he calls in the book he wrote as he was at the end of his life, called A Movable Feast, which the title suggests wherever you go in the world, Paris goes with you, because Paris is a movable feast.
Like everything else in Hemingway's life, there's a lot of complexities and contradictions. Jenny mentioned the quote from Gertrude Stein, the beginning of Sun Also, I should say, the Sun Also Rises, was really not what the quote was. The quote was from the Bible, was from, I guess, Ecclesiastes. And if you know, there are two quotes, one from Ecclesiastes and one from Gertrude Stein, talking about something a garage mechanic had told her about the younger mechanics today are a lost generation. Well, Ernest is furious about the fact that people focus more on that quote than on the quote from Ecclesiastes, which is what it's really about. He was not there to glorify the lost generation. A lot of young people read about the drinking and the carousing and the rivalries and all that. But his heroes were the people who lived in the country, the Spanish, who were close to the earth, and who were devout Catholics, and who had it together. Their lives made sense. But I think the key there in Spain was that he called it the Spanish Earth, capital E, as I was the Earth. The hero was the Earth, not the lost generation. So that was the contrast that he wanted to make. So for Paris, undoubtedly had a lot of some of the same element. And I think you see in The Sun Also Rises, after World War I, which was a disillusioned experience to so many people, it was the death of the old order that a lot of people welcomed. The question is what will follow it? Because there is not only tremendous physical devastation in Europe, tremendous cultural and spiritual devastation, tremendous searching. And so the lost generation, through drinking and carousing and all that, were in a sense trying to escape it or trying to find something else. So I think Hemingway and Joyce and others really saw themselves as responsible for some new culture that would be, you know, worthy of human nature as they saw it. And so I think that in Paris at that time, in the end, I think there was that struggle in all the arts, in film and painting and sculpture, literature. So it was not only a very exhilarating time in the sense of its immediate, spirit of the time, but I think in the bigger picture, it was a search for a European culture, a European identity in the wake of terrible devastation.
Regarding Hemingway's writing regimen, how he actually conducted writing, mentioned a great story, if you don't mind.
Well, and Jenny as well, Ernest had a a great commitment to work. His father was so strict that if he found him, and he was a Calvinist, Park, by the way, was very religious when they lived here. They said when the Teamsters came out from Chicago, they knew they were in Oak Park when the saloon stopped and the steeples began. Well, this religion was not only in churches, it was in the homes. And Ernest's home was very religious, and Mary, I know that Jenny can tell you a lot more about that later.
Congregationalist,
but they were very different religions on both sides of the family. But his father was a Calvinist. Work ethic was very important, and that drove Ernest his whole life. That and ritual were two things he learned. He did chores. Chores had rituals associated with them. Church had rituals associated with them. Writing had rituals associated with it. And so he makes a statement that he's very proud of the fact that he woke up every morning like it was a sunrise and worked until noon, whatever. And that was his Puritan side. And then the afternoon, he partied. And that might have been his Episcopalian or Catholic side, I don't know. He had a very strange, he told one of his sons, we have a recording of one of his sons saying that he forbade his kids to use any kind of bad language at all, except between 4 and 5 in the afternoon. He set aside some time, which gives you an idea of sort of the complexity of Hemingway. But it goes a lot deeper than that, because Calvinist side, or the Catholic side, or the Christian side, the religious side of Hemingway was very much there, but it was at war, perhaps, with a, let's say, pagan side or something, part of him that was very much a believer in the natural and so on. So I think he was very complex that way. But his writing reflected that, because he stood when he wrote, usually, and he tended to use typewriter for either dialogue or narrative, and handwriting for the other, or vice versa. But he made a distinction between what he typed and what he wrote by hand. The most important thing about Hemingway was that his initial drafts were often wordy, were often very self-serving, emotional, narcissistic, but it was in the editing that he rose to greatness. And I compare it to Beethoven, who walked in the Vienna woods and absorbed all this wonderful material, and sometimes took 20 years to get it into a symphony. So to understand Hemingway, he was not a quick writer. He was a thorough editor, and he agonized over every word, everything went down the page. He didn't try to write a lot of words every day. He tried to make them the right words, which was very difficult. So I think this
500.
Yeah, right. So I think this Calvinism, this work ethic, was very big for him, but it was also this idea that his party life and his life fishing and hunting and all these other things provided him the material that he did when he wrote alone. He said once that writing was a lonely act, and I think in his Nobel Prize speech, and every day he faced a page as it could be eternity or the lack of it. That's how profound it was. In this wonderful Chet Huntley and Brinkley did a biography when he died for NBC, which I think we have in our archives here, where Hemingway is standing before this white wall with this onyx, or this one of these antelopes that he had hunted over him. And he is very starkly dressed and so on. I mean, very austerely dressed, and he looks very austere in his face. And the caption is, "A writer must be chaste as a priest of God." And that sentence sums up a whole lot. That when he went into any country, even up in Michigan, they told the story, he was like a city slicker, they regarded him. This kid from Oak Park, he thinks he's a big outdoorsman, but he's got a few things to learn from us. This is what I heard from one of the guys up there that knew him. And he was a little resentful of Hemingway because he wrote about his sister, or his relative in a way, used her name that was not too flattering in his stories. And with all of these negatives about Hemingway, he said, but nobody could capture the country up here like he could. And whenever he went anywhere, he seemed to absorb the language, the culture, the tradition so well that he could give a mirror to the people of who they were. Now that's the one side of it. So it was provincial, he could pick up the provincial differences. The other side was that I think that he spoke to something universal in human nature.
I cannot begin to thank you so much for this part one.
You thought you were getting one and you had two for the price of one.
I know.
But now you have another 2 good hours over here.
A two-for day. And can't thank you enough.
Well, thank you very much.
Really,
I hope we'll see you again.
I hope so, too.
Maybe Saturday, huh?
Well, Virginia, this has been magnificent. Thank you, and Red, so very much for the time and energy and... Just, we're excited.
Passion.
And the passion. The passion. Yeah, but I think it would be important to make certain you invite everybody in the world to come visit this amazing place.
I think we extend our hospitality with great love and affection to those people who find in Ernest's life the pleasures of not only storytelling and reading, but the young man who became a world-renowned figure. And what better place than in this house, where, as we said before, in the first 6 years of his life, he truly became Ernest Hemingway. We are here every day from 1 to 5 in the afternoon, and on Saturday we can get you up at 10 o'clock and we will be here. So do join us and enjoy the story of a very special person.